take this opportunity to welcome our President, Sardar Arif Shah, sir, Secretary Sardar Diljon Singh Shah, former Principal Peacemaker, sir, Sri Indrajit Singh Ji, who is Secretary Sardar Leh Ladakh, our faculty members, dear friends, students, and above all, our today's esteemed invited speaker, Professor Vaidyanath Shukla, sir, who is Vice Chancellor, now Nalanda Mahavidyalaya, under Ministry of Culture, Government of India, and also Central Institute of Buddhist Studies, which is at the University. So, without taking much time,
thank you, sir. Sir got disconnected, I think due to some internet connectivity. Now, I would now request Professor Dr. Ranjana Das to kindly make her introductory note, and then we will move ahead for the main lecture. Over to you, ma'am.
To welcome all of you in today's Guru Nanak Dev series online lecture on the subject Buddhist philosophy and its relevancy.
It has been our tradition to invite and honor of distinction for delegating lectures before our students and teachers. First of all, I would
to Professor Vaidyanath Das.
It is indeed a privilege that we are being enlightened by Professor Vaidyanath Lal, a decorated scholar and recipient of numerous awards. It is such an honor to have you among us. Professor Lal is the Vice Chancellor of Nav Nalanda Mahavihar and Central Institute of Buddhist Studies, Leh Ladakh, Ministry of Culture, Government of India. He has edited 18 books in Hindi as well as English under the titles Buddha Prajana Sindhu and The Ocean of Buddhist Wisdom, and contributed nearly 90 research papers on different aspects of Buddhism, which have been published in the reputed journals of India, USA, Thailand, Bhutan, Cambodia, Mongolia, etc. He founded the Indian Society of Buddhist Studies in the year 2000. The Academic Association of Buddhist Studies, which is the National Academic Forum of Senior, as well as budding scholars of Pali and Buddhist Studies. He was honored with Rashtrabhasha Samman by the Jammu Kashmir Rashtrabhasha Prachar Samiti in 2009 and was honored with the Lifetime Achievement Award by the Institute for Environment, Yoga, and Social Security, New Delhi, in the same year. He was also honored as Somayaji Ritvik by the Hindi Sahitya Sammelan and the title Dharma Vibhushan by International Federation of Astrology and Spiritual Science, Chandigarh, India, and Matara, Sri Lanka, in 2005. He has recently been honored with Dr. Beni Madhav Barua Memorial Award 2018. The topic Buddhist philosophy and its relevance in modern world is very interesting and of great significance. Buddhism is one of the major religions in the world of the Buddha, are timeless and easy to practice. The Four Noble Truths contain the essence of Buddha's teaching. It was these four principles that Buddha came to understand during the meditation under the Bodhi tree. Today, in the scientifically and technologically developed global village, though there are many amenities for easy living and pleasure, people are both spiritually and mentally not satisfied and do not have a feeling of security. Buddhism offers a few very simple and efficacious methods to combat this. Buddhism has a rule to play in our life, and it is our responsibility to share our thinking, knowledge, and experience with as many as possible, so that ultimately the message of the Buddha continues to reach mankind in every nook and corner of the world. Bodh dharma आज दुनिया के प्रमुख धर्मों में से एक धर्म है. गौतम बुद्ध ने जो हमें सिखाया वो न केवल 6th century BC बल्कि यह एक अनंत शाश्वत और टाइमलेस टीचिंग है, जिसे निश्चित रूप से 21वीं सदी और आने वाली कई शताब्दियों तक अभ्यास किया जा सकता है. पाली के धर्म सूत्रों में बुद्ध को 32 महापुरुषों के लक्षणों से युक्त एक असाधारण पुरुष के रूप में चित्रित किया गया है. उनका नाम तथागत भी है, अर्थात जैसे आए थे तथा वैसे ही गए. गत गौतम बुद्ध मूलतः एक धर्म सुधारक थे, लेकिन यदि गहराई से विश्लेषण किया जाए तो पता चलता है कि महात्मा बुद्ध ने किसी नवीन धर्म की स्थापना न करके प्राचीन धर्म में चली आ रही कुरीतियों को दूर करने का प्रयास किया. बौद्ध दर्शन गौतम बुद्ध द्वारा स्थापित एक अनिश्वरवादी, अनात्मवादी, क्षणिकवादी तथा कर्म प्रधान दर्शन है. दुख और दुख से मुक्ति ही बुद्ध के सिद्धांत का आधार है, एवं बुद्ध के द्वारा बतलाए गए मार्ग को मिडिल पाथ या मध्यम मार्ग की संज्ञा दी जाती है, जो अत्यधिक लिप्तता अथवा अत्यधिक संयम दोनों को नकारता है. इतना ही नहीं, भारतीय धर्मों के इतिहास में इसे एक तरह की क्रांति के रूप में भी देखा जा सकता है, क्योंकि यह वर्ण व्यवस्था पर भी हमला करता है तथा बगैर किसी जातिगत भेदभाव के बौद्ध संघ में लोगों को तथा महिलाओं को भी पुरुषों के बराबर दर्जे से शामिल किया गया था. और यही वजह है कि इसे भारतीय दर्शन का सर्वाधिक मानवतावादी एवं व्यवहारिक दर्शन माना गया है. I seek to welcome everyone present today in this lecture. I welcome the president of the Sardar R.S. Chahal, the secretary of the college, Sardar Diljon Singh Grewal, Professor P. Shekhar, member of the governing council, governing body, our principal, Dr. Sanjay Prasad, Sri Indrajit Prasad Singh, secretary of study center, Ladakh, Jammu and Kashmir and Jharkhand, Tapti Chakravarti, and Vinoti Trivedi, and I also welcome all my colleagues and students. I hope all of us will be hugely benefited by today's lecture, and the students will have a feast of information and ideas on the subject. Now, I request Dr. Lab to present his lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Before sir begins, I would like to read a quick introduction about Lab sir. He is with us. Professor Lab has edited 18 books under several titles and contributed several research papers on different aspects of Buddhism in reputed journals around the world. He founded the Indian Society for Buddhist Studies in the year 2000 and served the society as its secretary for 18 years till 2018. He is the Vice Chancellor of Navanalanda Mahavihara and Central Institute of Buddhist Studies, Leh Ladakh. His awards and recognitions are many, but to name a few, he has got Rashtrabhasha Samman by the Jammu Kashmir Rashtrabhasha Prachar Samiti, Lifetime Achievement Award by the Institute of Environment, Yoga and Social Security, New Delhi, Somaiji Ritwik by the Hindi Sahitya Sammelan, Dharma Vibhushan by the International Federation of Astrology and Spiritual Science, and Dr. Beni Madhav Barua Memorial Award in 2018, to name a few. Now I would request Professor Dr. Baidyanath Lab to kindly start his address. Over to you, sir. So you will have to unmute yourself and
अब मेरी आवाज जा रही है?
यस सर।
सबों को नमस्कार, सत श्री अकाल। इस महामानव गुरु नानक देव के नाम पर स्थापित गुरु नानक कॉलेज धनबाद के प्राचार्य महोदय डॉक्टर रंजना जी, इंद्रजीत जी, श्री पी शेखर जी और अन्य सभी जितने महानुभाव इसमें सम्मिलित हैं, उन सबको मेरा नमस्कार, सबको सत श्री अकाल। शुड आई टॉक इन इंग्लिश और हिंदी और जिसमें आप ज्यादा कंफर्टेबल फील करें?
सर, यू कैन यूज बोथ एक्चुअली, यू कैन यूज बोथ, या
ओके ओके ओके। डॉक्टर रंजना दास हैज ऑलरेडी स्पोकन अ लॉट इन सूत्र फॉर्म अबाउट बुद्धिज्म, व्हाट बुद्धिज्म मींस and how it developed, how it came into existence. There is a lot of controversy about the dates of the Buddha, and now it is being pushed back to sometimes in 17th century BC. But anyway, keeping that issue apart, most of the scholars accept that his date of birth year was 624 BCE, and death, that is Mahaparinirvan, is 544 BCE. Although some of the historians have told that, mostly it is written in the books that 563 and 483 BCE, but this date has been rejected by majority of the scholars, and even the UNESCO and most of the Theravada countries accept that his dates are 624 BCE and 544 BCE. Anyway, there's a historical part of the Buddha, and we all know that he was born at a place called Lumbini, which is now in Nepal, but at a point of time it was a part of Magadha. And the place Kapilvastu is in UP, although some Nepalese scholars claim that it was in Nepal, but it is well established that it was in UP, Siddharth Nagar, and the place is called Piparhava. Anyway, we all know that Dr. Ranjana Das ji has spoken that he did not start any new religion. Religion, of course, is a word very in a limited sense. We call dharma, and dharma is the religion. The word religion is not the exact or the full translation of dharma. It doesn't cover all the aspects of dharma. Dharma is much bigger. But since in English there is no other term, so that's why we are bound to use the word dharma, religion. So anyway, he had come here, come to this world to rectify the malpractices or misinterpretations of our scriptures, which had come up with the passage of time in the doctrines of the Vedas and Puranas and Aranyaka Upanishads, etc. So instead of emphasizing on any rituals that is quite visible in different dharmas, the Buddha declined all that. They refuted the practices and the malpractices or whatever we want to call, and he emphasized on the process of spiritual advances, which does not involve any ritualistic practices. And like Upanishads, he also emphasized on the attainment of Paramagyana, that is Sambodhi or Prajna, which can be attained through Sil, Samadhi and Prajna. We know that when we start reading about Buddhism, we first come to know the Four Noble Truths. And these Four Noble Truths, that is Dukkhang Arya Satchang in Pali, Noble Truth of Suffering, Dukkha Samudayang Arya Satchang, that is truth of Noble Truth of Origin of Suffering. Then the third is Dukkha Nirodha Arya Satchang, that is Noble Truth of Cessation of Suffering, and Dukkha Nirodha Gamini Patipada Arya Satchang, that is Noble Truth of the way leading to cessation of suffering. So these are the Four Noble Truths, the basic pillars of the Buddha's teachings. And the beauty of Four Noble Truths was that the Buddha always told that the whole life, a person suffers because of certain reasons, not necessarily every time, but the suffering is quite pervasive, all pervasive in life. So, according to him, suffering is a very common feature. And he told that jati pe dukkha, jara pe dukkha, maranang pe dukkhang, apyehi sampayogo dukkho, piyehi vipayogo dukkho, yankinchi ichchang na labhati tang pe dukkhang, sankhiten panch upadan khandha dukkha, jati, this birth is suffering, old age is suffering, separation from loved ones is suffering, association with unloved, whom we do not like, that is suffering. And in brief, the whole, so while suffering is, in fact, suffering, according to the Buddha, is a mental state, a feeling. Sometimes, cite one very common example, that if we are passing by some way, some place, and we find that a crowd is there, and somebody has met an accident, our heart palpitation increases. Is it somebody of my family, of my association? And we get anxious, and we try to just peep into to see who has met the accident. And the moment we find, not my friend, not my family member, but my enemy. And the moment that we find that, we get relaxed, and we rather start thinking, okay, it's better that he has met an accident. If somebody is there who is not known to us, we think, okay, it's okay. It is a common phenomenon, and there are a number of accidents and killings every day, so we don't care. So incident is the same, that some person has got accident, so met some accident, but we react in three ways. Either we feel pain, or we feel pleasure, or we remain indifferent. So it is feeling that makes us different, or to react in different ways. That is why the Buddha says that suffering is a mental state, basically. And he also finds out that suffering is not imposed, it has not been imposed on us by any unseen force. Rather, it is originated due to some reasons. So in the second noble truth, the Buddha says suffering has a cause. There is a cause of suffering, there is a origin of suffering. And he reveals that there are three types of regions, three types of desires, Krishna, Kam Trishna, Bhava Trishna, and Vibhav Trishna. Sensual pleasure, a sense of sensual pleasure, or desire of sensual pleasure, then desire of taking rebirth again and again, and also desire of getting emancipation. So because of these three desires, these three types of desires or cravings, we act in certain ways. And that becomes the, these three regions become the origin of suffering, the cause of suffering. In the third truth, the Buddha says that if there is cause, there must be some way out also, and suffering can be removed also. And if there it is completely destroyed, then this is the possibility. And that is why in the third truth, he says, Dukkha Nirodha Ariya Sachang, cessation of suffering. Suffering can be ceased also. And the fourth truth, he says that if there is possibility of eradicating suffering, there must be some way out also. And in the fourth way, truth, he says, Dukkha Nirodha Patipada Ariya Sachang, that is, there is a path, there is a way out. And what is this way? This way has eight steps. That is why the fourth truth is nothing but the Buddha's eightfold path, noble eightfold path. Samyak Drishti, Samyak Sankalp, Samyak Vachan, Samyak Karmant, Samyak Ajiv, Samyak Smriti, Samyak Samadhi, Samyak Vyayam, Samyak Smriti, or Samyak Samadhi. So these Samyak means proper, correct, right. So by following these eight paths, one can get emancipation, one can get freedom from, permanent freedom from suffering. And some of the other features that, unfortunately, I have to leave for airport by 12. So I may not be able to continue for a long time. And it takes about 1 hour from here, from my place to an IGI airport. So these four noble truths and eightfold path, these are the basic pillars or the basic features of the Buddha's philosophy. And the again, he talks about the three features or three types of truths, three types of characteristics of this phenomenon. And sarvam dukkham, sarvam anityam, sarvam dukkham, or sarvam anatmam. Everything is impermanent. Nothing is permanent according to him. That is why he believes that everything is in the course of flux. Everything is momentary. Nothing is permanent. We think that our life is permanent. There is a time when we are born as a baby, but we do not remain baby. And every moment we are growing. We are growing, and there comes a day when we are grown up. Mustaches and beards and other things, they appear on our face. Female body develops in a different way. And there comes a time when we get old and we die also. Nobody can stop it. So that is why the Buddha says that everything is impermanent. Sarvam anityam. And if there is sarvam anityam, if there is momentariness or there is change, there is impermanence, then it cannot... It is a matter of suffering. So in the second lakshana, second characteristics, he says, sarvam dukham. And sarvam anatmam, unlike the Sanatana philosophy, the Buddha talks about no soul. There is, according to him, there is nothing like a permanent soul, as we find in the Gita or in the Upanishadic philosophy. That the best example can be seen in the Srimad Bhagavad Gita, where the Buddha says, Nainam chindanti shastrani, nainam dahati pavaka, na chainam kledeyanti api na shoshayati maruta. It can neither be cut by any weapon. It cannot be burnt by any fire. It cannot be wet by water. And it cannot be dried by air. So it is just like a static thing, Atma, that is soul. The Buddha does not believe in that, but still he talks about rebirth. So this is something very peculiar. And as we find in the, again, I'll quote Srimad Bhagavad Gita, where the Krishna, Lord Krishna says, Vasansi jiranani yatha vihaya, navani grihanati naro parani, tatha sharirani vihaya jiranani, anyani sanjati navani dehi. As we give up the worn and torn clothes and we put on new clothes, similarly, when the body gets old, the Atma, the soul, also leaves it and transmigrates to a different body, to a new body. So, but despite refuting the existence of permanent soul, the Buddha says that there is a rebirth. And who takes rebirth? So, in place of a permanent soul, eternal soul, he talks about mind and body, nam roop. Mind, the subtle part of our personality, and roop, this is a physical part. So they are interdependent. And mind cannot exist without body. And body has no meaning without mind. And there is a continuous flux, continuous flowing of mind and body every moment. We do something good or bad, and accordingly, as a result of that, there is in birth of or the origin of new nam roop, new mind and body. And that is in that way it goes on. The association of both flow like a river. We find, or we sometimes very usually say that, okay, I had gone to the Ganga and I have taken 5 dips. But the Buddha says that it is not possible to take 5 dips. 5 dips in the same river. In the first river, when it took the first dip in the river, that water flew and new water came. It seems, it looks as if the same, but in reality, if you look at the matter very minutely, we will find that the water that in which we had taken the first dip has already flown and new water has come. So similarly, out of ignorance, we find or we say that it is the same, but in reality, it changes. But it does not change completely. That's why 10 days earlier or 5 years earlier, we had met and we recognized you even today and you recognized me, but we did not remain the same. So that is why the Buddha explains how rebirth takes place, but and how long it will continue. About that, he says that until we get rid of desires and we perform some actions, good or even bad, or even with desires, with a sense of getting result, we will have to continue. We will have to take births and rebirths and rebirths and rebirths. That is why he talks about the process of Sila Samadhi Prajna or the Eightfold Path has been summarized into Sila Samadhi Prajna. These are now two different things. So if he prescribes that, okay, by practicing Sila, we give up wrongdoings and we are motivated to towards performing good actions, moral actions. So by practicing sila, we are able to rectify and our physical and vocal misdeeds. And but that's not enough. If we want to advance toward, move towards nirvana, moksha, or emancipation, the first we have to control our physical activities, physical actions, also misactions. So seal helps in that. So, and after that, mental purification is also necessary, because the Buddha says that one place, Chetanahang Bhikkhave Kammang Vadami. O monks, I call this volition is action. What is volition? A sense of determination, a sense of resolution that we take at the level of mind before doing good or bad. That is sankalpa or chetana. So he says that chetana itself is a karma, because first of all, we determine at our mental level, and then we perform into physical action or vocal action or sometimes mental action by thinking even good or bad, or cursing anybody. So that is also action. So the Buddha says that by performing, by practicing sila, one becomes able to control and purify his physical and vocal actions or vocal misdeeds. And after that, he has to proceed towards mental purification. And mental purification is possible through practice of samadhi, concentration. Dhyan and samadhi, we find two terms. Dhyan is means towards getting or obtaining the state of samadhi. And samadhi is one-pointedness, ekagrata. That is why the Buddha says, kusal chit ekagrata samadhi in Pali. Kushal chit ki ekagrata ko hi samadhi kehte hain. Aisa bagule ki bhanti jo machli ko pakadne ke liye bagula bhagat bana rahta hai, lekin uske andar killing ka sense hai, to ek dusre ki hinsa ka sense hai. To in the context of samadhi, we find no place of immoral thinking. This moral thinking, moral mind. So concentration or one-pointedness of moral mind is proper samadhi. And that is, of course, it is a very big issue or big topic. It cannot be summarized into in few minutes. So by practicing samadhi, it is a not very easy task. We, in the case of Guru Nanak Dev Ji, we find that he was a great wanderer. He had covered a major part of the world on foot even. And a person whose picture when we find, all he is always in meditation. So that meditation is something to look into within, not without. So by practicing samadhi, one gets free from outer world or disturbances of outer world, and ultimately, after practicing sincere and continuous practicing, there comes a time when his mind is fully concentrated. And after that, the practitioner finds that, okay, I'm physically and vocally pure, purified, mentally pure, but still there are some factors which are in seed form, in dormant stage. They are not active now, but there is chance of their revival, their reactivation. So they are called, in Buddhist terminology, they are called sangyojan, that is fetters. They will be translated in English as fetters. So fetters are some bad or negative elements which have been subsided, but not completely destroyed. So if a person wants or desires of getting full emancipation from the cycle of birth and rebirth, desirous of getting nirvana, he has to destroy these fetters also, these sangyojanas also. Sangyojan means unite one word with the another word. This is another word. They are 10 in numbers, and one by one, the practitioner removes and destroys them, and ultimately, when all these 10 fetters are completely destroyed, he attains the stage of Nirvana. And Nirvana is Deha Mukti, this stage is possible to be achieved even during this life. So, Nirvana is also of two types. One attained in when this life remains, and another when this is also gone. So, Nirvana that is attained in this very life, when all the five aggregates remain, means when all this body is alive. तो जीवन मुक्ति की अवस्था जिसको कहा गया है तो ये भी एक निर्वाण है जिसको पाली में या बौद्ध भाषा में इसको कहा गया स उपाधि शेष निर्वाण. उपाधि मीन्स जो रूप वेदना संज्ञा संस्कार विज्ञान ये माने गए हैं फाइव फैक्टर्स फाइव एग्रीगेट्स व्हेन दे रिमेन मीन्स इन शॉर्ट व्हेन दिस लाइफ वी आर अलाइव. सो इस अवस्था में जब वो मिल जाता है निर्वाण उसको कहते हैं स उपाधि शेष निर्वाण. और उस समय में उसके बाद जो व्यक्ति कोई कर्म करता है whether it is good or bad तो करता ही नहीं है तो वो उसका कोई अटैचमेंट नहीं रहता है, उसको किसी फल की इच्छा नहीं रहती है कि मुझे पुण्य मिले मुझे स्वर्ग मिले मुझे मुक्ति मिले कुछ भी, वो सभी इच्छाओं से मुक्त हो जाता है. इसलिए उसका कर्म केवल कर्म मात्र रहता है. तो वो जीवन मुक्ति की अवस्था जिसको कहा गया है वो जीवन मुक्ति की अवस्था है, उसको स उपाधि शेष निर्वाण कहते हैं. और बाद में चल करके जब वो भी समाप्त हो जाएगा, जब यह शरीर भी समाप्त हो जाएगा, तब जो निर्वाण मिलेगा उसको कहेंगे अनुपाधि शेष निर्वाण. तो बुद्ध के केस में जब हम कहते हैं कि उनको ज्ञान मिल गया और सिद्धार्थ गौतम से वो बुद्ध बन गए अंडर दी बोधि ट्री एट बोध गया, दैट वॉज ही स उपाधि शेष निर्वाण. And when he passed away at the age of 80 at Kushinagar, that was his Anupadi Shesh Nirvana. So these are some of the main points of Buddhist philosophy. I'm sorry that I could not be with you for longer time. I have to move for airport. I myself now very satisfied. And I will look forward if I get some another time to be with you and talk about Buddhism and Indian history, Indian philosophy, Indian culture. So with these words, I stop here and I express my hearty gratitude towards my elder brother, Indrajit Ji, Dr. Ranjana Ji, Dr. Sanjay Prasad, and all faculty members, all members of management committee of Guru Nanak Dev. Ek baat aur keval kehkar main samapt karna chahta hoon. Guru Nanak Dev ji aur Bhagwan Buddha ke beech mein bahut sari common baatein hain. Ek baat jo hai ki wo bahut badi baat thi ki us samay mein Buddha ke samay mein Sanskrit bahut badi prachalit bhasha thi aur elite class ki language thi. To Bhagwan Buddha ne kya kiya? कि जन भाषा को अपनाया ताकि उनकी बात अधिक से अधिक लोग समझ पाए. उन्होंने संस्कृत को नहीं अपना करके पाली को अपनाया. और वही बात हम गुरु नानक देव जी में देखते हैं कि वो जो सिंप्लिसिटी उनमें थी, जो एक सेंटहुड था, और जन भाषा को उन्होंने अपनाया ताकि उनकी बातें अधिक से अधिक लोग समझ पाए, सीख पाए और उसे कन्विंस हो पाए. तो ये इन बातों के साथ मैं दोनों महापुरुषों जो इस भारत भूमि पर पैदा हुए, भगवान बुद्ध और गुरुदेव नानक गुरुदेव जी, उन दोनों को नमन करता हूं और अपनी वाणी को विराम देता हूं. आप सबका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर. Any questions? I would request students, if they have any question, you can please be quick because sir has to leave for the airport. अगर आपके सवाल हैं तो आप प्लीज जल्दी से पूछ लें क्योंकि हम 5 मिनट में सर को फ्री कर देना चाहते हैं. Do you have any questions, students?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
If you have any questions, please drop in the chat box quickly. No questions?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. So now I would request Professor Abhishek Sinha to please offer the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Varsha ma'am. Good afternoon, all of you. गुरुनानक कॉलेज द्वारा संचालित गुरुनानक देव लेक्चर सीरीज में इतिहास विभाग के द्वारा आयोजित आज के कार्यक्रम के मुख्य वक्ता अंतर्राष्ट्रीय ख्याति के विद्वान प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर श्री वैद्यनाथ लाभ जी का हृदय से अभिनंदन के साथ आभार एवं धन्यवाद व्यक्त करता हूं कि सर आपने अपने व्यस्तम समय के मध्य हम सबों को बौद्ध धर्म और दर्शन पर विशेष व्याख्यान से अवगत कराया. मैं आभार एवं धन्यवाद मैनेजमेंट कमेटी के संरक्षक एवं अध्यक्ष सरदार आर एस चहल जी, सचिव सरदार डी एस ग्रेवाल जी एवं पूर्व प्राचार्य प्रोफेसर पी शेखर जी को हृदय से धन्यवाद देता हूँ कि उनके सहयोग एवं पर्यवेक्षण से यह व्याख्यान सफल हो पाया. मैं प्राचार्य डॉक्टर संजय प्रसाद जी को भी धन्यवाद देता हूँ जिन्होंने हमें कुशल निर्देशन इस कार्य को संपन्न कराने में दिया. मैं इंद्रजीत प्रसाद सिंह अध्यक्ष स्टडी सेंटर लेह लद्दाख झारखंड को भी धन्यवाद देता हूँ. मैं प्रोफेसर ताप्ती चक्रवर्ती प्रोफेसर विनोदी त्रिवेदी को भी धन्यवाद देता हूँ. मैं अपने विभागाध्यक्ष डॉक्टर रंजना दास मैम के प्रति हृदय से धन्यवाद देता हूँ. उनके अथक प्रयास और लगन के कारण इस ऑनलाइन लेक्चर को हम संपन्न करा पाए हैं. इसके अलावा तकनीकी सहयोग के लिए डॉक्टर वर्षा सिंह, प्रोफेसर उदय सिन्हा, प्रोफेसर पुष्पा तिवारी, साधन मिश्रा को धन्यवाद देता हूँ. विभाग के शिक्षक गण डॉक्टर सरिता मध्येशिया, प्रोफेसर अर्णव सरखेल, प्रोफेसर करुणा सिंह एवं अन्य सहकर्मियों एवं छात्रों को धन्यवाद देता हूँ. धन्यवाद के साथ समाप्ति की घोषणा करता हूँ. एक बार पुनः सभी को धन्यवाद.
Thank you, Abhishek sir. With this, we come to the end of today's session. Thank you for joining everybody. We will upload the recording of this webinar on YouTube as soon as possible. You may watch it again and again. Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much. Have a nice day ahead.